You are listening to the Tricorder Transmissions. Or leave. Episode 6.
Just what the doctor ordered. Right, doctor?
I couldn't have prescribed better.
Your ship has arrived at Space Dock, and it's once again time for Shore Leave, the show dedicated to Trek convention chat. I am Jeff Hewlett, and with me once again is the always awesome Heather Barker.
Hello, how are ya?
I am doing okay. How about you?
I'm okay.
Just okay? How was that Denver Comic Con?
I'm coming down from being around too many people. A bit overstimulation. It was fun, but it was a lot of people. This convention is only 3 years old. I think it's three or four. And it's been growing and growing and growing every year. And this is the first time that I've gone. So I didn't know what to expect. And, you know, I'm used to the Rio convention hall layout and knowing where everything is and knowing the corners to run to when I need a minute. And so I felt very out of my element at Denver Comic Con, but lots of cosplay, some Star Trek people. So that was fun. Definitely.
Very cool. Well, I'm glad to hear at least it wasn't a total wash.
Anywhere where there are Trekkies, Heather is happy.
There you go. So is it an official Comic Con or is it one of the knockoff Comic Cons?
It's an official one. Oh, it's wow. Not like a Wizard World or anything. It's run by a group here called Comics in the Classroom. And embarrassingly, I don't know a whole lot about them. Or maybe it's like pop culture. Okay, go to the website. Sorry, guys. because I am probably not saying something right there. But anyway, it's huge. And they had, Carl Urban is here one day.
Oh.
I'm thinking of just trying to think of Star Trek people. I know that Garrett Wong and Brent Spiner were here yesterday. And poor Garrett was tweeting that their panels overlapped. And his was before Brent Spiner's. And unfortunately, like some people were saying, you know, sorry, we're going to miss your panel because we have to go get a good seat for Brent Spiner's.
Oh, man.
I feel terrible.
Poor Garrett.
Yeah. But so they have, I mean, of course, this is not just Star Trek. It's all kinds of Comic-Con people. I can't remember. I think Stanley was here last year. He might be here this year again. Honestly, I just didn't pay a whole lot of attention to who was going to be there. I just wanted to go have the experience because I haven't been to a convention like this. Since like 2004. It was the inaugural year of MegaCon in Orlando, and MegaCon has grown into just a gargantuan con. So similar, I think Denver Comic Con and MegaCon are probably very similar. MegaCon might be a bit bigger, but yeah, there's only one other small convention here in Denver, and that one is Fan Run, and it's held in a hotel in the Denver Tech Center. And so actually I think it's three hotels now, but it's smaller. It's a different experience, and probably I would put STLV as like right in the middle. It's not too big, it's not too small. So it perfect for me. But I don't really go to Starfest anymore because they do kind of focus on Star Trek and Stargate actors. But it's people who we see every year in Vegas.
Overlap, yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, there's – for me, I don't really get buddy-buddy with any of the actors. So I'm not, like, guaranteed that I'm going to be Nana Visitor's best friend when she's there. I know that the smaller cons lend to more intimacy, especially with their panels and the Q&As. But I find that STLV is, like, just the right mix of being more than Starfest. And now I know, not quite as crazy as Denver Comic Con, although we don't know what's going to happen in August.
That's true. We have no idea. It's only 6 weeks away. We'll be finding out very soon.
45 days until I get there. I think technically it's 46 until the actual first day of the convention. Yes, because
we get in the day before.
Yeah, but so 45 days until we arrive on Tuesday, which blows my mind every time we get closer and closer. And I can't believe it. I feel like we just left like last week.
Yeah, blink your eyes and we'll be there.
Yep.
Yeah, very, very soon. So today, this is, of course, our sixth episode of Shore Leave, and this is going to be part one, because we've got so much content, we figured we'd split it into multiple episodes. This is going to be part one of our Vendor Room Spectacular, where we are going to have some guests on that are going to be in the vendor room at Las Vegas, and not necessarily always just vendors. We're going to have some of those, but we're also going to have some exhibitors here with us as well. So we're going to be breaking them up over a couple of episodes here, because I think we probably totally have about six or so at this point. This episode is going to focus on the first two. And first up is going to be Gabrielle de Cuir and Stefan Rudnicki from Skyboat Media, who are going to be stopping by to talk about the new Harlan Ellison City on the Edge of Forever audiobook. Heather and I were fortunate enough that we got the chance to listen to this audiobook over the last couple of weeks. And I was very excited that Gabrielle and Stefan were going to come on the show to talk about the making of the audiobook and give us lots of really fun insights into the voice actors and how they put it all together and the recording of all the parts and Harlan's role in the audiobook. It's phenomenal. So that's going to be coming right up, and we don't want to get too spoiler with it, so we're not going to really talk about the actual content so much of the audiobook, but we're going to get into some of the behind-the-scenes stuff. Heather, how did you feel about that audiobook?
It was enlightening. I think that it's a must-read for anybody just to understand both sides of the story, so to speak. But I guess there are people out there who may not even know that there are two versions of City on the Edge of Forever. There's the one that we've seen, and there's the one that Harlan actually wrote, which the first screenplay was definitely very different from the final episode. But I think knowing the story, knowing the complexity behind it, makes it even more special to me. So I was honored that we got to listen to it and enlightened as I listened to it. What did you think?
Well, I had read the comic adaptation of it back in 2014 as it was coming out, these graphic novels. So I had read the story that Harlan originally wrote through that comic. So I knew what to expect from it. But what really stood out to me the most is the introductory essays that Harlan actually reads before the teleplay starts. That is so full of information. And I know a lot of people, you know, they know Harlan Ellison as a boisterous, opinionated guy, and that he definitely is. But there's a lot of genuine moments through there where you can really understand his point of view and why he's so angry and frustrated over the entire situation. And you can sympathize with him a bit. So definitely, definitely check it out. And the teleplay itself is just phenomenal. The voice actors they got for this were all really, really good. Everybody did a great, great job. And it's the next best thing to actually seeing it.
Yeah, absolutely. I remember when the comic book came out, or graphic novel, I think they wanted to call it. And I read that too. So I also knew, and it just shed some light. And I think it's important to know both sides of the story always. So
most definitely. So especially TOS fans, definitely something to get your hands on. They're going to be at the convention, so you'll be able to pick up a copy there along with some other stuff. They're going to go over all of that when we talk to them in a few minutes. And Heather, who else do we have lined up for this?
So we have my wonderful buddy, Mikki Gunter of Make It So. If you are in the unofficial Las Vegas Star Trek convention group on Facebook, then you've probably seen her posting. She's been posting about getting some ideas on what we would like to see, because all of her items are handmade. They're very unique. They're stuff that you're not going to find at the other booths. I know sometimes as I go around, I start to see a few of the same items. You won't find that with her. So she's talking to us about that. And we rambled a little bit about tattoos and whatnot, but that's something that attendees are also going to be able to take advantage of if they stop by Mickey's booth. She's working on some flash art with them, and so she's going to tell us all about that, which is really awesome.
Yeah, it's a really fun discussion, and you guys kind of get into a lot of different topics while we were talking. It was a lot of fun for me to sit and listen to you guys. You guys have such a great rapport together, so it's really great. And there's a lot of fun information about how she makes the things, how she comes up with the ideas, and
yeah,
that's really fun to hear. If you're into handmade crafts, if you're into specialty items, and it's always cool to hear how artists make their products. So I think that's going to be it for this episode. So we're going to go ahead and get started with Gabrielle and Stefan here in a moment. And Heather, is there anything else about STLV? Any news that you wanted to cover before we go into it?
Oh, gosh. I'm trying to think what all has been announced. And it's mostly guests at this point and a few more photo ops, I think. But I think that we're all kind of expecting some bigger announcements to get made in the next 45, 46 days, maybe some guests from the JJ verse.
Yeah, they always seem to save something for really close to the con.
Yeah. So, I'm hoping for surprises and a bit more information. They do a lot of group photo ops, and I don't think there are that many up at this point where they'll do the various cast photo ops and then certain characters together. Mm. So we don't have a whole lot of information there. I'm expecting them to pull out some punches, and otherwise I'm just getting ready to pack.
Yeah, you think probably gonna take you a good week or two to get all that stuff packed up, right?
I've still been thinking. I'm like, well, I've got to take this and I've got to take that, and what dresses I'm going to wear and what cosplay I've got to bring. And there's a lot to think about, a lot to prepare for. So I better get started soon.
You going to be shipping anything, or are you going to pack it all?
No, I think I'll pack it all. I'm flying Southwest, so I can have some bags. I love Southwest. Yay. So no, not this time.
All right, well, let's jump right into our first segment of our Vendor Room Spectacular with Skyboat Media. Hello again, everybody, and welcome to part one of our Shore Leave Vendor Room Spectacular. Heather is here with me today.
Hi, everybody.
Hey, Heather, how's weather out there in Colorado?
Oh, it's gorgeous and hot, and I'm preparing for Vegas in that way.
Vegas is coming in 6 short weeks, but before we get there, we're going to be talking to some people who are appearing in the vendor room at the convention this year, and this is the first part of our Vendor Room Spectacular, and today we have with us from Skyboat Media, Gabrielle de Cuir and Stefan Rudnicki. How are you guys?
Hi. Hello. Hi, we're great. We're very honored to be here.
Well, welcome to Shore Leave. So we connected on Twitter, I think, a few weeks ago, and you guys were involved in the new Harlan Ellison audiobook. Can you tell us, before we get into the book, a little bit about Skyboat in general?
Sure. Skyboat Media, in various guises, has been around for quite a while as an independent production company for audiobooks. And recently, over the past couple of years, we've also begun publishing audiobooks. We've kind of targeted specifically genre classics and more modern works of science fiction, fantasy, horror, thriller, dating probably from the 40s right up to the present. And we've been looking to unearth a whole bunch of things that might have a fan base or should have a fan base, and trying to bring some of these things before the ears of the public.
Right. As an audiobook company, we've produced all of Orson Scott Card's work, Ben Bova. Recently, Stefan did the Samuel Delaney. We did a full cast production of Ender's Game Alive 2 years ago. And we produce all of the podcast stories for Lightspeed Magazine. That's an online magazine edited by John Joseph Adams. It's been around. We've been working with them for 6 or 7 years. And we've acquired 2 Hugo Awards the past 2 consecutive years for doing those podcasts. We do 8 of them a month.
8 a month. Wow.
Wow.
I saw you also had gotten some Grammy Awards.
Yeah.
Uh-oh.
That's out of the genre, but very important, and we're very honored. The first one goes back a ways for the Children's Shakespeare All-Star cast, and the second one, most recent, is for Janice Ian's autobiography. Society's Child, yeah. She recorded here in the very studio where we're sitting and actually played the musical intros and sang to each of the chapters right in our little studio here. So it was quite a project.
I remember hearing that song when I was younger. My mother had played it for me, and it's very controversial at the time.
It's still controversial.
Yeah,
I guess so.
Very moving.
So how did Skyboat get involved with the Kickstarter project and the audiobook for Harlan Ellison?
Well, maybe we ought to start with how we got involved with Harlan Ellison.
Oh, okay. Even better.
We've been producing Harlan's stories mostly for nearly 20 years now. When we were working at Dove Audio, was the big independent back in the 90s, Harlan showed up and we started doing some story collections on audio. And we've been his producer pretty much since then for audio recording. So we've done, I don't know how many, I mean, it's now seven, I think, collections of short stories, as well as most recently we've published his two first novels, Web of the City and Spider Kiss. So this is a relationship that
goes back a long time. Stefan played the voice of the TikTok man in Harlequin Repent, which is one of Harlan's famous stories, with Robin Williams. It was Harlan and Robin and Stefan, and it was a ride.
Yeah, there was a cool radio series for public radio called 2000X or Beyond 2000, which was produced in 1999. Which had dramatizations of major science fiction works, and I got to executive produce that and actually stand at the mic next to Robin Williams. It was quite an experience.
That had to be incredible. I'm a huge Robin Williams fan, so I'm actually quite jealous.
So anyway, what happened basically with this was that in our discussions with Harlan, it came to light that this particular teleplay that he had retained the rights to the original. A lot of folks may not know there is an original version, and of course then the aired version, which is very different from the original. There's two versions out there. Harlan retained the original rights, which were the rights to the one that won the Writers Guild Award. And when I found this out, I went nuts because, you know, I'm a Star Trek fan from having been there watching the original series. And when I said, "Are you sure you have these?" And he was Harlan. I was like, very opinionated and strong. And he said, "Well, of course, you silly, but whatever." And then, you know, what it's not only the teleplay, but the essays surrounding it and Harlan's complete rant, if you will, and backstory on what went on at the time. So I was just jumping up and down, knowing that the 50th anniversary was coming up. We felt the clock was ticking on this and that it needed to be voiced. It needed to be done. It's expensive doing multi. We wanted to do the teleplay multi-voice, and we peddled it about a bit to some of our clients. And it's not that they were interested, but they didn't want to move as quickly as I felt we needed to move. And so we turned to the crowdfunding and figured that if we can't get the support, if the fans want it. We want to do it, obviously. So we started. We started without any funding.
Yeah, we took a risk.
We took a big, big risk.
Harlan has had some health issues, and we were able to bring him into the studio late last summer into the fall for several sessions to record his lengthy and very important introduction to this thing, the rant that Gabrielle referred to, which is actually an amazing perspective on the state of television in the 60s in general. But he came in and over a series of several sessions and several weeks recorded his introduction. So we had that. then we started planning recording the teleplay, figuring, okay, that's the centerpiece. How are we going to do that? So, we did that as well. We recorded it all in one day on December 1st, still without the funding. I'll let Gabrielle continue with the Kickstarter.
So I thought if this won't work on Kickstarter, nothing will. And I would like to see Kickstarter actually begin to support more audio. We've got movies and we got books and we have, you know, whatever. We have whatever that was, the cooler or whatever. You know, if we have blenders, you know, we should be able to have audiobooks as a category on Kickstarter. So we put it together and boy, that's a lot of work.
Yeah.
Wow. But the response was phenomenal. The fans came out of the woodwork and from so many different unexpected directions. We had one of the gentlemen who went for the big Associate Producer Award from Italy.
Wow.
I got this email and I was like, where, you know, and then I contacted him and I said, well, you know, cause you go easy. You don't know who these people are. I said, do you know Harlan? I mean, I assumed that was, you know, that was a lot of the source. And he said, no, I just get very angry when people mess with screenplays and teleplays. Oh, wow. And I was like, okay, you can be a producer. That's, you know. Friends of Harlan, people who supported our work, and then just fans, you know, from all over that had this common place to come to give us a vote of confidence. And it's incredibly heartwarming, just wonderful.
I think that speaks volumes about what you were going to put out there, because I know in the past few years, some Trek fan productions have struggled on Kickstarter while others have really taken off. So the fact that yours gained such great support just must have been very reassuring and affirming.
Very much so.
Yes, it was. And it's a beautiful piece of writing, guys. Mm-hmm. It's just on its own. And in fact, we found that when we came to the casting of it, you know.
Not only did you guys put this whole project together and do the Kickstarter for it, but both of you also got to be part of it, some of the voice actors on it. I recognize both of your voices having listened to the whole book. So I was going to ask you how excited you were to be part of the project, but how excited were you to actually be part of the actual reading?
It was a terrific day. There's an amazing thing that happens when you concentrate a lot of people's energy, particularly when they have a real commitment to the work, into a single limited time frame. What happens is that everything gets compressed. And that was very much true for December 1st. People started showing up pretty early in the morning, and we had some food out, so they didn't starve. And already the buzz, even with the first two or three people who showed up, was pretty incredible. For me, working in that kind of setting with a bunch of people, when you have a real time limit, it's very much like working on a film, particularly an important scene. You've got one shot to really do it right, whether it's the light or some particular opportunity, some particular piece of equipment or an actor availability. You got one shot to do it right. And this was very much like doing a very compressed motion picture in a short period of time. So yeah, it was tremendously exciting. Everybody was committed to the project, knew what they were doing, and we just sailed through it. Logistically, scheduling this kind of thing is very tricky because with a film, what you usually don't shoot in sequence. Well, we did pretty much. We got this thing done from beginning to end in sequence so that the people who had roles all the way through could get a sense of their own continuity. And it was like experiencing the events in the teleplay personally, in addition to performing them.
Yeah, I come from it mostly as a director. That's what I worked on mostly with Ender's Game and the technical and the creative aspects of making sure that this moved to fulfill Harlan's vision and sound what it needed to sound like. Normally, we would have days to do this type of project. But with the financial restraints, we just crossed all kinds of technical barriers. We threw open the doors to the studio. We set up two mics where the main dialogue would go. The other thing we had on this was that we have Harlan's teleplay directions are brilliant because it's Harlan writing. You know, it's just not move camera left, move camera right. There is commentary. There's texture.
Yeah, normally that's something that would be left out
of it. You'd want to cut, you know, but with him, no way.
Or in fact, what you do is create sound effects or music effects that would substitute
that for that would bridge those transitions, you know. Mm-hmm. So from the top, I knew I wanted the narration in there, the teleplay directions in there. But then we thought, I don't know, if we have just one narrator, obviously, again, financial restrictions. I'm like, okay, Stefan can narrate the whole thing, right? The voice of God can do it. We got this covered. But then I really wanted him to do The Guardian because it's just gold. You know, you can't throw that kind of opportunity away. No. So we got in touch with LeVar. We've worked with LeVar Burton on, we've produced all of his Reading Rainbow Kids books on the app, over 500 of them at this point in time.
Spectacular.
And, LeVar expressed great support for doing it, but again, time constraints on everybody's schedule. So Stefan came up with the brilliant idea of rotating the narrators. The teleplay is set up in the standard 60s prologue, four acts, epilogue. So what we decided was to allow different people to narrate each section. I was drooling at the thought of LeVar saying, you know, the Enterprise hanging in space. I mean, yeah, I thought the studio was going to explode, you know. I was just like, okay, fine, whatever, you know. So that's what we did. We started, with LeVar reading the narrator. Now, I'm sitting in the director's chair, and I've got my wonderful daughter assistant, Cassandra, who's directed 1,000 different things, sitting next to me, being really like a script supervisor, okay? And we've got one day to do this in. And we have, 15 people coming in.
Many of whom are only available for
a couple of hours, you know. So we started with this, and I tell you guys, it was just magic. You know, LeVar sits down. John Rubenstein, who's a Tony Award-winning actor, amazing, amazing actor, played Captain Kirk. Scott Brick, who is a superstar in the audiobook world, in the booth playing Spock. And they start, and it's magic. We were going to do I was going to do a rehearsal and then a record. They didn't stop. They just went. And then, you know, it's LeVar is done with the prologue. David Gerald is the next one, you know. And so he comes in and sits down, you know, and then they continue. And that's how the day went. We went into the afternoon and we've got, you know, the incredible Jean Smart in to play Edith. I'm just goosebumping all over the place. But it was magic. You know, I mean, here in the back of my mind as a technical person, I'm thinking, oh my gosh, you know, we can't flub. We're not going to get these people back to do a pickup. I mean, that's not going to happen. But everyone was on their game. And what was so funny is that they were giggling too in between. They were high on this. They were signing each other's scripts like yearbooks. You know, LeVar's going, Scott Brink coming to, okay, sign mine. It was that much of an event.
Wow.
Yeah. Well, it is widely regarded as the best episode of Star Trek, and this is its original form. So it had to be an honor to be part of bringing that to life, I would imagine.
Well, yeah, and having, you know, David Gerald, who wrote the Tribbles episode, which is the other top contender, it was magic. It really was.
So I know we're limited on time. Something that I really wanted to talk to you guys about, and after listening to this, and especially the essay portions read by Harlan at the beginning, you understand how important the character of Trooper was to him. What was it like having him voicing that character?
I don't know how to describe it because he just became Trooper.
Yeah.
he just did it.
Yeah, the particular character, and we don't want to get into it too much, but it was very important to him in terms of the plot and the symbolism of the whole, that whole time period.
Well, it gives an historical context.
Context, yeah.
Right.
To the story and to the moral issues that it's about.
Yeah, I mean, he came in and there's not many lines and he just nailed them. And it's again, historically, it's wonderful and tremendously satisfying, you know, even though he won't admit it, to him to be able to tell the story and then do that part.
Yeah, I mean, he wrote the part for himself. Had something resembling the original writing been aired, that role would have been in there. And he would have played the part. I mean, he was a Broadway performer. I don't know if you realize that. He sang and danced.
Sang and danced
in the original Broadway production of Kismet. I mean, all kinds of musicals.
So I assume that he wanted to do this role. Yes. It wasn't suggested to him. He wanted to do it.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
Very cool. So, you know, speaking back about those essays, I know we skipped right to the actual teleplay, but do you guys have any recollections about the recording of Harlan reading those essays?
Yeah, it was at times very painful for him.
Yeah.
Going back over that, and at times anger-making, and at times he just sailed. Yes, I get to say this.
Yes, we both worked with him in the studio.
Yeah.
On that piece. Again, there are some just very extremely revelatory sections of how the writing process worked at that time.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And again, I don't want to give it all away, but just a completely different world from the type of TV writing we're talking about now.
And there's, from Harlan, there's a lot in that introduction that's very personal and that is not necessarily me versus Gene Roddenberry talk. It's more like, you know, this was what it was like. This is what hurt. This is what made sense. It's a rich analysis of not only a creative time in history, but also a very creative relationship among others.
Yeah, and very personal.
Yeah.
In the sense of how he navigated the controversy and even his changing attitudes toward it through those years.
Yeah,
that definitely comes through when listening back to the introductory pieces. And they do go on quite at length. So there's a lot of great information in there to set up the stage before the teleplay is read. But so we know you guys are here on the show on Shore Leave because you're going to be at the Las Vegas convention in the vendor room. So I wanted to dedicate a little bit of time to talking about what your plans are for your table or booth at the vendor room in Las Vegas.
Yay! We are so excited. We've done a lot of conventions, but we are so excited to be welcomed into the Star Trek world. We broke the piggy bank and got a booth, so we're very excited about that. So we have a little space to spread out and do our thing. And very, very pleased that CBS approved us to come because, you know, obviously we are not a licensed Star Trek product.
Right.
And so there was a little trepidation there, but they've been very generous. And what excites me about the booth and the convention visually is that we can really create something unique. Obviously, we cannot, nor does it make sense to use any of the existing visuals. But I deal with words, but my dad was a four-time Oscar-winning production designer, film designer. So I have visuals also. And nobody's got a copyright on 1930s Depression New York streets. So, and even costume. And I've got a lot of, and Harlan actually had some visual things that went on, her blue cape and her scatter pins with the sun on it. And I'm hoping to manifest all of those and share that. I think it's going to be a fun visual break for everybody.
Cool. So what type of product are you going to have available at the table? Is there going to be any exclusive content or?
Yeah, we're going to have actually the whole program exclusively on a USB that has the artwork. And I need to mention here on the artwork, we are so lucky. We had it done by Hugo winning Elizabeth Leggett, a fan artist, and it's beautiful. It's just stunning. So we're going to package the program on USB. We're also going to make it available with Harlan's other two novels as a package. Mm-hmm. And of course, we have the anniversary edition, which is the physical CD copy, which will be available there. And then we're going to have, you know, a big package, which will have Elizabeth's artwork, both versions. There's a cast list poster, and then there's a very dynamic Harlan piece. So that's kind of what we're looking at this point.
And we're also going to bring some samples of our other science fiction releases to broaden the interest a little bit.
Yeah, we're going to have, you know, samples from our 150 book library of science fiction and fantasy also available. Mm-hmm.
There's such a wide audience that I'm sure you'll have a lot of success with bringing those.
I think so. We've found that. We've been to, you know, to WorldCon and WonderCon and kind of getting the word out there. And there's a huge audiobook base fan for science fiction and fantasy. So we're looking forward to that. But I can't wait for the convention. This is just going to be, it's going to be so much fun. It's going to look great and it's going to sound great.
Are both of you coming?
Yes.
Oh, heck yes.
Yes.
Yes, and we're bringing several people from our staff here.
Oh, great.
We've got ourselves we rented a compound in Vegas because we figured working out of the hotel rooms was going to drive us nuts because we're, you know, bringing all this stuff. So so we're going to kind of have a home base and work from there. And we're really excited about it.
Yeah.
It's going to be fun.
So you'll have extra people to cover the table so you guys can actually go around and experience the convention and not be stuck in the vendor room.
Absolutely.
Oh, of course.
Yes, we need little breaks there.
Yeah, conventions, as you no doubt know, can be incredibly exhausting.
Yes.
Especially if you don't have people to...
A little relief, yeah. So we've got people and we will have them costumed and we're going to have fun.
Oh, that sounds great.
Oh, yeah. We're going to have a look.
That sounds good. Is this your first Star Trek Las Vegas?
Yes!
Wow!
Yes! That's cool. Why I said thank you to everybody for welcoming us so much in terms of the Kickstarter support, in terms of you guys having us on. We're very excited.
Oh, wow. We are too now, knowing it's your first time. Is there anything specific that you're really looking forward to that you've seen maybe on the creation site? Or
We've had some conversations with Larry Nemechek. Larry did an essay for the book, which if you get the audiobook, that's on there too. So we've been talking to him, and we know he's up to some good stuff. And we have worked with a lot of these guest stars who are there. We've worked, with LeVar. We've worked extensively with Will Wheaton. I don't know if Will's going to be there. He's not on the list yet. He signed up for Birmingham. I saw that. Nana Visitor. We've done series of audiobooks with her in the past. Yeah. Terry Farrell is a personal friend of Stefan. So we've got a lot of, there's a lot of serendipity there. That's
Rene Aubergenois.
Aubergenois did the Bible with us. So
wow.
So there's a lot of fun stuff out there.
Yeah, plenty of Skyboat Trek connections.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. I love that you've already got the connections in place, so you'll get to have a reunion of sorts with your friends there.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's going to be fun.
So in closing, is there anything else that the two of you would like to share with the audience about what you're going to be doing at the convention or anything about the book that we haven't covered?
I want to give one word about... I loved the original episode. I want to go on record as saying I still love it.
We do too.
It's great. It's just great. And I love Harlan's version. Mm-hmm. And I don't think they are exclusive to each other. I don't think that you have to just like one or just like the other one. I think, and that's mainly why I wanted to do this piece, is because they are beautiful in both ways, and they do not discredit each other in any way away.
They complement each other. Yes. There are lots of reasons why, in the format that it was written, with many of the specific effects called for, that Harlan's original version really didn't suit what the show was doing at that time. I mean, when he wrote it, the show was in its infancy.
Right.
Once they really looked at it.
Yeah, it's very important to remember that the world was not fully created, although I'm sure Gene had obviously the vision of where he was headed. And even in casting, it was interesting because we cast this as though we had never seen a Star Trek episode.
Right.
I mean, we had to go to Harlan's words, marry ourselves to his descriptions, and go from there. I still would like to see this filmed.
Yeah. But even when we brought, or this issue was brought up when we did a panel at WonderCon, and there was some discussion among the audience, which was very interesting and really led to very much a sense that these two different episodes that are also the same shouldn't be mutually exclusive, or, you know, if you like one, you shouldn't like the other. No, that they really, historically especially, complement each other in a very important way.
I couldn't agree more. In fact, I think Heather and I were having a bit of a conversation after we had both finished the audiobook, and we both realized that Harlan's version of the script, it almost seems like it could easily be done as a modern episode of Star Trek if there was a series in production today, or even as one of the new films.
Modern motion picture.
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah.
It's got that much complexity, depth, and it's long.
It certainly was. Well, I have to say, having listened to it and very much enjoying it, I think that the production value of this is extremely high. You guys did a wonderful, wonderful job with the casting and the recording and the producing. It sounds phenomenal. Anybody out there who wants to purchase this audiobook, you can't possibly go wrong. I very thoroughly enjoyed it. I'm very glad that I got a chance to hear it. Heather, do you have anything you wanted to add to that?
Yeah, I would say this is one that you can't miss. I think that you need to hear it, especially if this episode is fond to you. It's very important that you hear this story and all the words that everyone had to say about it. It was meaningful to me because of that. This episode is my favorite of all Star Trek episodes. And it the complexity that's there, I can't agree more that both versions definitely complement each other. And just the depth of what was going on behind the scenes is something that is very important to learn. So please, please buy this and listen.
So Gabrielle, the Cuir, and Stefan Rudnicki, thanks so much for coming on board the Shore Leave show here with us. And if people are looking for yourselves or the book, where can they find out more information?
At skyboatmedia.com. One word, skyboatmedia.com.
Wonderful. And of course, if you're coming to the Vegas convention, you can also purchase the audiobook there, along with some artwork and other things. So
come see us.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Heather and I will be stopping by your table frequently, I'm sure.
Yes.
Yay!
Absolutely. I'm excited. I'm excited to see what you guys pull out. So
Heather's a big cosplayer. So
good. Okay.
Thanks a lot, guys. This has been wonderful.
Thank you so much. You guys are great. Thank you.
Thanks.
Hey, this is part two of our four-part Vendor Room Spectacular here on Shore Leave. It's me, Jeff Hewlett, and Heather is back with me once again.
Hi.
Hello. And for this second part, we have yet another guest. This time, we are talking to Mikki Gunter from Make It So, and that's S-E-W. Mikki, thanks for being part of Shore Leave.
Yeah, thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
No, absolute pleasure.
So excited.
It'll be fun this year, 50th.
Oh my gosh, it's going to be overwhelming, but I'm stuck right between like being super mega excited and a little apprehensive just because of the amount of people.
Would you like to start crocheting for me? Because I
do you have like a little team? Like your Cinderella's mice is what you need and the little animals to help you.
Yeah. It was like when Bernie had that bird land on his podium. It was just like, that's great, but can it clean my apartment or crochet? That's what I need. The person who helps me is my mother. And I pay her with Netflix and love.
Oh, what a great combination.
That's good arrangement.
She got a raise this Christmas. I gave her the code to the HBO Go.
Ooh.
And fancy. And recommended Deadwood and said, watch Deadwood.
That's but serious.
I have, actually this year, I did outsource a little bit more because normally, Heather, you know, and people probably don't know if they want to look up Make It So on Facebook, they'll see that I usually crochet everything. Mm-hmm. That beanie caps, the BB-8s have been huge this year.
Yeah.
Before the movie even came out, the BB-8s were selling really well. I think it's because I was pretty much one of the first ones to just look at the design and say, yeah, I can do that. Thank you for making a BB cap on top of a yoga ball for me. That just made my life easy. And so those with the R2D2s, those do really well. Everybody loves those. But last year, I sold out of my Spock hat on the first night, on the preview night.
Wow.
Yeah.
And this year we've got 5.5 days of vending.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because you've got the registration night. And that's like six or something when it opens to gold, I think.
And last year it seemed like they let just anybody in.
I think
it was limited to, which is great, which is good news, but I don't think they limited it to just the people who pre-registered.
Right. It's hard to tell. Like, once you get a wristband, I guess, because I know that they check your wristband when you go into the vendor's room.
Oh, yeah. Even ours are.
Oh, I believe it.
Hot glue gunned onto us. They're not to remove them. They are not to come off at all. So.
Yeah. So then you're going to have to really stock up to make sure you get through the 5.5 days.
Right. I just want to make sure I have what everyone needs. But again, like I said, most of my stuff is crocheted. Darren just wore one of my Spock hats on him and David Ivey's video cast now. Is that what it's called? A video?
Trek cast? Is it?
Yes. Yeah. So Trek cast has now gone from being just a verbal cast to video on YouTube.
Oh, I didn't know that.
I know, right? Because they didn't advertise that well. But it's on there. And my hat is on there, and I was so stoked. But I think it made me realize that I kind of need to bust a bunch more of those out.
Yeah. Well, my favorite are the little, like, crochet Spock ball man. I don't know what you call it. And then the Kirktopus. I got a Kirktopus last year. Because they're just really neat. I mean, it's just really original, fun stuff at your booth that you don't find anywhere else, I think.
I don't want to be sued.
Right.
People send me ideas all the time, and I love it. I love it. I just like, hey, can you make this? Someone challenged me during a Renaissance Fair if I could make a Mervin the Martian hat.
Oh.
And I did.
I remember that.
I was pretty stoked because I just kind of, I look at it. I look at other people's and how they do it. And I just try and come up with a pattern in my brain.
Wow. That's talent.
I run as I go. And if it works, it works. And if I make plenty of mistakes. Oh, my goodness. Trial and error, trial and error, trial and error. But once I get a pattern down, then I'm good to go. And I can just start making stuff. I attempted a wharf hat.
Oh.
So, it's okay. I'm not going to go posting any pictures of it yet. I'm proud of myself how I was able to get the hair.
Yeah.
The ridges is what I'm having difficulty with right now.
Definitely.
The eyebrows, boom, done, good, nice big forehead. But it's the ridges I'm just having issue with right now.
Yeah, that sounds challenging, especially like without a pattern or something to really go on.
Yeah, and so, like I said, it's a lot of trial and error. I do not want to ever take anyone else's patterns
or
ideas and stuff like that. Like the Spocktopuses and the Kirktopuses and all those that came because someone challenged me to make an octopus.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh my gosh, guess what I could do with this? So that was fun, especially coming up with the hair.
Yeah.
For Kirk, especially the little.
I love him. It's just so unique and different and fun.
Yeah, and you liked it more in Shatner.
Oh gosh. And so you also had like little like Vulcan ear wrap type things.
The ear cuffs. Yeah.
Yeah.
Those are cool looking. Those are.
Thank you. They're you know absolutely utterly handmade. They're just.
And you're gonna have those this year.
Fingers apart. Yes, I will have a good chunk of them.
Good.
But for the most part, they're made to order.
Right. Okay.
And so this year, when I bought the table, this year I've got a table with a wall.
Oh, wow.
I know. I'm going to have a whole wall behind me.
It's like prime real estate.
I know, right? So I got like a sign and everything, and I'm like all super official. Even though awesome. This is like super hobby for me. But yeah, so this year I made sure I asked last year if my table with wall for the 50th could please be in a specific location that has no neighbor.
Ah.
So that I can sit someone actually next to me and fit the ear cuff to them.
Oh,
and
cool.
Then once I get the size, then they can go wander off for 10, 15 minutes and I'll sit there and I'll work it and I'll work the metal.
Wow.
And just do that. And then when they come back, it should fit perfect.
That's awesome. That is really cool.
Any sharp edges and stuff.
I was going to ask, like, if you were going to have something specific for the 50th, but honestly, just that in and of itself. I mean, it's not, you know, directly 50th something, you know, it doesn't say 50 on the little wire ear, but that is just really, really neat and like, not even improvement, but just something to offer that is just, oh, I like it. I'm sold.
Think, yeah. And then I have other, you know, wires I can wrap around them, the blue, red, and gold. I can personalize the colors. I have beads. I love working with beads. I absolutely love beading. So if they want it a little bit, I'll have a little bit more flared ones this year that I'll pre-make. They'll be a little bit more difficult, but if someone does want a custom one that I'm out of, at some point, I can say, yeah, sure, you know. They'll just see me at the masquerade bar over there beading.
Oh, gosh. I did get,
for this year, like I said, I outsourced a little bit more than I usually do this year. And I found someone who does, he had a laser cutter.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, and he was laser cutting wood. For the Renaissance Fair.
Oh.
He was making, and my daughter went and she ran off with her money and she came back with a next gen insignia lasered into wood.
Wow. I like it.
It was just like, okay, I need to know who this person is. Is there a machine available? What kind of ideas can we come up with? What can we make? And we've got, let me see, I can count. I'll have to get up and count them because I'm actually making a spot cat as we speak. Let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, about 35 designs in keychains.
Wow, that's awesome.
So I've got all different kinds of sayings. I tried to, you know, of course, I looked up what I could and could not use. For instance, like everyone, you know, beam me up, Scotty. CBS the crap out of that. But they only own it for apparel.
Oh, see, this is all very interesting to me because I've always just wondered. And then the creation put up on their website the other day something. Let me find it so I can just read it.
Oh, yeah, probably like, it's probably the same warning they give us vendors. That at any time CBS or someone representing CBS can come by and shut our booth down with no refund and no warning.
Yeah, it's along the lines of like they won't have any non-licensed products there. I mean, it had, and we don't want to get into the whole thing that it relates to. It's relating to some of the fan fiction stuff that's going on.
Ah, yes.
But I was concerned about, like, how does that affect the vendor's room? Because there's so many products in the vendor's room that are Star Trek related, but I know they're not, like, licensed.
Oh, yeah, no, so, totally. Yeah, that's they give us that threat every year. They tell us this will be my second year vending legally, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
Should we tell them about the yard sale? So they give us a warning. Okay, at any time CBS or a representative of CBS can come by and shut you down for having unlicensed stuff.
Wow.
And it's terrifying. It's absolutely gut-wrenchingly terrifying. Thank goodness my cousin is a copyright lawyer.
Oh, wow. Ooh. That's handy.
So we looked up a lot of stuff, and the last time we looked it up, and this was just, the last time, they don't even own Live Long and Prosper.
Okay.
The copyright was let go in 2009.
Okay. Interesting.
But, like I said, don't quote me on that. We looked that up years ago.
Yeah.
So it could have changed by now. Who knows? And why let it go in 2009 when the new movie was coming out? It just doesn't really make any sense.
Right. That's a tricky to get around all that. And
But the Star Trek symbol itself is a math symbol. It's the data symbol.
Right.
It's kind of, there's little tiny ways. And plus, most of the stuff, like I said, even I love the vendor's room. I have even... not just as a vendor. The vending came because I love being there.
Yeah.
And I want to be with you guys and my family and my friends. And, how many years ago was it? Two or three years ago, people started showing interest in some of the stuff I was making.
Yeah. This is the third. Again, mm-hmm. That first year was, So,
thank goodness, though. That's what motivated me. Whoever, rightfully told on me.
Yeah.
Because I was doing wrong.
Well, I guess. I
should have done it after hours.
Yeah, just so people know, so Mikki was just kind of starting. She was making her stuff, and so she decided to, sell it to friends and whatnot, and was doing it out of her room, and somebody told Creation. So Creation shut her down.
Well, they sent a security guard. We don't know.
They might not have been directed
to Creation. I only invited 200 of my closest friends. I made the mistake. Never a mistake. I went and saw Carl Urban speak.
Okay.
Like, I just had to. Like, I wanted to hold up my Dread 2 question mark sign, Please. And so I sent some friends out with the flyers I had made, and they flyered the vendor's room.
Okay.
So it was probably somebody in the vendor's room, which is great because I thank them.
Because
thank you. You motivated me to take my stuff out of my room and put it in a vendor's table.
Yeah, which is awesome. And you did really well last year. I know people were coming by. And like you said, you were selling out of stuff. So
last year was awesome.
And again, it's just you have such unique things to buy compared to the other stuff.
And that's what I tried to do. Like with these new keychains, actually, they can be anything.
Right.
I bought the mechanics to make them keychains, but you could technically make them into anything. And some of the sayings were kind of fun. this is where you're not going to get this anywhere else.
Yeah. Yeah.
Unless you have a laser cutting machine. And I have a great friend who works there who can do this for you. It's just I want to make sure that people who come by my booth get something that they're not going to be able to get anywhere else. And, I have that saying, nothing says I love you like someone else's hard work. I feel that my things are not only great for, you to buy on your own and for you to have and to do, but I think they're great gifts.
Yeah.
Like, definitely. I pride myself on having stuff that people want to gift to somebody else.
Yes.
And I say, oh my gosh, that's, the Star Trek convention. It was great. I saw this. I thought of you. This was something you totally had to have.
Yeah.
And instead taking a picture of it and sending it to them.
Exactly. And I mean, again, as I've said, I'm just a huge fan. I don't know what they're actually called, the little spot crochet ball dude.
I call them I call them plushies.
Okay. Yeah, I guess. I mean, that's what it, he is technically, but that's just something that you don't see. And like I saw, and of course I buy them for me because I'm selfish. Yes,
and that's why. I believe I'm a collector too.
Jeff has seen pictures on my computer desk that I'm looking at right now that has Star Trek stuff and My Little Pony stuff and BB-8 and yes, so
all our geekdom, we wear it proud now.
We do. Fly that flag.
Geek closet and
fly that flag.
Geek is the new black, so it's
I know people that have bought stuff from you for gifts, especially with the little plushies or great baby gifts.
Yes. So
they'll know
I use safety eyes. I changed to using safety eyes so that they could actually have them and not choke a child to death.
Yep.
I don't think my cousin can cover that.
Probably not.
I do warn people, though. There are certain things that are not meant for age 3 and under.
Yeah.
You know, like, I do make sure. I just want to make sure they're safe. I love my Trekkie necklaces.
Yes.
I love wearing it out. I love
the Spock one is iconic. Like, the Spock with all his little movable limbs.
Oh, I don't make that one.
Oh, you don't? Okay. No. I thought you had made that one.
No, I wish. That's a girl in Arizona who I've been trying for years to collaborate with, and she doesn't get back to me.
Bummer.
I know. I try and tell her. I'm like, you can literally consign through my booth.
Yeah, that necklace is super popular. Like, that was one of the first things I saw, I think, when I met you for the first time. And I was just like, oh my God, your necklace.
Right, yeah, exactly. I only had a couple, you know, for my own personal use and stuff. But this year I'll have, I'm doing a collaboration with Counts Tattoos in the Rio.
Oh, right. Right. Yes. So
I have offered them a small space on my table to show their flash art.
Nice.
And we will all be talking to the manager about maybe, like, if you mention my booth, you can get like a little discount or something.
I like it. I have talked. That's why I asked you the other day about if Shane was the manager.
Yes, for you.
Because back in, I guess it was the first year we were at the Rio. Counts, I think it was the first year, Counts had flash stuff for a set price. And it was, I don't remember what the price was, but it was specifically Star Trek stuff.
Nice.
And so I know like Holly Amos got a tattoo. I'm not sure who else. I just remember because she posted pictures. But when we went back in 2012, they didn't have anything like that. And I went in and I was like, you know, you guys, you've got to move on this because people are here and a lot of us have tattoos and we want to get stuff. And we'd rather get something Star Trek, and it's really easy to just show us some options and let us choose. And maybe it's, you know, a little less expensive than it might normally be at an on-strip tattoo parlor. Right.
Right.
So we had talked a little bit back and forth and just nothing, like they never did anything. And so when Shane came on as a manager, like he found like my Yelp review and reached out to me. And so I was supposed to meet up with him last year, the one before, and things were just overwhelming and it never happened. But I know we really want to make something happen. And so this is great. Even if it's just an avenue through your booth where you've got that stuff.
Make people aware. I think the main thing is that, like, hey, just so you know, because a lot of people, I'm sure they do the same to you. I'm almost positive you probably get stopped constantly
all the time.
Oh my, is that a, you know?
Is that a like, Stargate address?
Oh my God. Yeah.
It's a Stargate address.
And the stuff you wear, hello. like, it's probably constant. So same, you know, like people were taking pictures of my Star Trek tattoos at Gay Pride.
Yeah.
I'm like, can we focus on the issue here, please, people? but, you know, and I'm flattered. I really am, especially if they get the tattoo I got last year.
Right. Was it the Horga?
Yeah.
Or the Horgon. Yeah, Horgon.
If they actually get what that is, you may be the man of my dreams, you know, kind of thing. So why not incorporate, like, hey, yeah, these are my Star Trek tattoos. Copy them and I'll cut you. But look at this flash art.
Yeah.
You get this tattoo for name a price. I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't do flash art ever. Not ever.
That's a tough one. Anytime, just for people that don't have tattoos and don't know about it, they usually have like a base rate. And your local artist is typically not as expensive as an on-strip Vegas artist will be. They do overcharge, but I'm hoping that they would at least do something. Like my artist, I think his minimum is like 80 or 85.
Is that locally for you?
That's locally. So I'm hoping that they might do like 100 for something
I think
would be great.
I think I can talk them into $30 to $50 tattoos.
Whoa.
I do.
Whoa. That'd be crazy. Jeff is going to get a tattoo.
Woo! One of us. I think I can talk them into some of the smaller things for probably 30 and up. Wow. You know, that'd maybe. Cool. We'll see. I'll talk to him. I'm going out at the end of this month to go see Andre, who's my guy.
Awesome.
And yes, I pay. I know perfectly well I'm paying, you know, strip prices.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm at least paying, at least in my opinion, I'm paying a little less than strip prices. I know I'm getting a good discount. I know I'm getting a good price considering how many I have.
Right.
And you know, how many different places I've gone. Normally I hit up like a Friday the 13th.
Right.
And I try and find someone who's cool enough to not do flash art. I assure them I will tip them accordingly. That's another thing, too.
Yes, tip your tattoo artist.
If you're going to get a tattoo anywhere, I don't care where you are, tip the artist. Don't steal other people's work and tip the artist.
Yeah.
Those would be my biggest faux pas I think people do in the tattoo world is...
Definitely.
Is they steal other people's art. It's art, people. These are our, this is our art. I'm running out of rooms on my walls. I'm just saying. But, you know, and then tip the artist, man. I don't understand who people don't know how to tip.
They just don't. I think it's just not something that people get.
You know, there are tattoo artists. Kids are going to college because of me.
Yeah.
You know, tip your artist. I had a guy come to my friend's house and tattoo us all day long. All day.
Wow.
All day. He sat there. I got three pieces done. And some touch-ups on some other things. And it was $500. We tipped him $200.
Yeah. Especially if you've worked in a service industry type job and you've lived on tips, I think some of us just tend to be very generous tippers. But you'll have to keep in touch with us and let us know what happens there so that we can make sure that everyone knows to come to you to get that discount.
Yeah. Let's see if we can work something out. You'll be the first to know. And
yay,
let people know too. Remind everybody, we do have that feed going on Facebook on suggestions.
Yeah. Yeah. I need to bump that up.
Like I'm definitely the Klingon symbol. You know, maybe LLAP in Vulcan or yeah. You know?
Yeah, the Vulcan calligraphy. I've got two of those.
The Gallifreyan.
Yeah. Definitely. Go ahead.
Oh, go ahead.
Jeff has gotten awfully quiet, so I wanted to...
Oh, no.
I thought you left. I was just like, okay, bye. It's just us girls.
No, that's quite right.
Did you see any of my stuff last year? Did you, by any chance?
I did.
Did you?
Of course. Yay. Of course I did. I made about 8,000 rounds through the vending room.
Yeah.
It's the best room. I love the vending room.
Yeah, it's a wandering room. So I must have hit every table. I've got a handful of times.
Multiple,
each.
Yeah.
Yeah, in my travels. But I was going to ask you about some of your Trek products. And, you know, Heather, I kind of picked up on this that Mikki was saying that she does a lot of commission type work on ideas that people throw at her. I was thinking, why don't we throw out the Tricorder Transmissions logo?
Oh,
I don't have to see it.
TOS Tricorder.
Let's see. Okay, so original series Tricorder.
Yeah.
I drew
it myself.
A crochet one?
I don't know if you could crochet it. That sounds extremely difficult, and I'd have to pay you a lot of money. I don't know. Like,
I made a Geordi visor.
Neat.
Oh.
You can't see through it.
I wonder, like, with the laser printer, like, if you could take the logo and then do that image as laser printer.
If I don't, the thing is that it's so funny. I just actually started doing inventory on what I got from him because he only does the machine seasonally during Renaissance fairs.
Right. Mm.
So right now it's packed up from the Southern California Renaissance Pleasure Fair. And Ooh. He's headed up to Pirate Fair.
Pirate Fair.
Northern California. The people keep putting out that they need help. And I'm like, oh, God, I wish I was not a peasant. oh, the woes of the medieval times. But his machine is only good during the off season, so I don't get him again until after August.
Okay.
I know. I had all these ideas. I know. I already, I had so many ideas.
Well, now you know for next year.
He wants to make a tricorder out of wood.
Ooh.
He showed me a gun. And hello, NSA. Thanks for tuning in. I hope you enjoy the rest of the show. We'll be hilarious. So he did like a pirate old-timey musket, handheld mm-hmm. muskety kind of gun oh, nice. Out of the wood. Three panels, all screwed together to make one 3D-ish wood pistol. And it was very interesting looking. Fun toy. You know, the trigger doesn't work or anything. It's just a fun thing. But he said he wanted to try a communicator and a phaser. Hmm. So I set him to that. I said, you go, you let me know how that turns out, because you'll be in Northern California. And I'm pretty sure that if he can get it to work the way he sees it in his brain, which might be the same way I see it in mine, you guys might get one. You might get a
wood.
That
would be cool.
It'll be after August, but, you know.
Yeah. Well, we'll see.
You know, we'll see. I, however, can probably try and crochet one.
That's a challenge, so don't push yourself. I can't even imagine doing that, but good idea. I'll look at
like a million pictures of them.
Yeah.
Like every angle and try. I got a little obsessed with those jellyfish.
Yeah, they're really neat.
Yeah, last year was octopuses. This year it's jellyfish. So I've got a bunch of jellyfish. But people have been showing interest.
I need to get a jellyfish from you.
I don't think I'm going to Star Trek those out.
Yeah.
So can you give us a rundown of what Trek-related products you will have at the convention?
I'll have the Spock ears for all sizes, yes. From babies to adults, because I kid you not, nothing is funnier than putting a baby in a hat. It's the best. My child model is very, very hard to work with, so I get very in Spock hats. But I've got Spock hats coming. I'm going to have any of the, what are they called? Red, the TOS colors, red, golden, and blue for anyone. Just regular beanie caps, that kind of thing. I have still a lot of the octopuses left over from last year. And I have the main big Trek stuff is going to be the collectibles, the keychains that we had printed this year. They're just fun. I have, you know, Space, the Final Frontier. My other ride is the USS Enterprise.
Oh, I love it.
He's dead, Jim. Trekker or Trekkie, depending on your preference on how you refer to yourself or others. The infinity, you know, infinite possibilities, Bajoran. It's just, these will be fun. These are new, all Star Trek, and then some Marvel, a few Marvel ones, because you know me and Captain America.
So we're all geeks. So yeah, Star Trek people also like other geekdoms. It's okay to like Star Trek and Star Wars.
Right. Yeah.
So, and yeah.
Star Wars stuff too. I know that the Star Wars stuff does well. Stormtrooper hats for this year will be good. The BB-8s look great. Yoda hats. If I can get this Worf hat down. Oh, I do have new this year the Live Long and Prosper glove.
Oh, right.
So it does. I wouldn't necessarily call it an oven mitt because you can't. It doesn't need to be used as an oven mitt. If you don't want it to be, it can be just a glove that separates your four fingers into two. Or you know, and I was thinking, I got a nice blue that reminded me of Andorians.
Oh.
And so I was thinking of maybe making an Andorian antenna headband.
Yeah. Oh, that would be cute.
And then just having some white hair coming off of it.
Yeah, that would be cute. I think that's a winner.
And then, a lot of the other stuff, it covers all spectrum of geek.
Yeah.
It's I don't just limit myself to Star Trek, even though it's my main geekdom. For sure, I realize that other people, even at the Star Trek 50th anniversary, 3 years ago, my biggest seller was Minion hats.
Yeah, I believe it. Everybody loves those Minions.
Minions. Really? even Rod Roddenberry bought a Minion hat for Zale. it's just kind of, well, that kind of tells you where the sales are going to go.
Yeah.
Last year, Jack Skellington hats. Couldn't keep
them. Oh, yeah.
Couldn't keep them. People ate those up. I know you saw, but I don't know if Jeff saw the picture of me cosplaying Captain America with Joss Whedon. It's the best picture in the whole wide world. But I crocheted a shield, a Captain America shield, and people have been asking me about those. So I might make a few more, but a little smaller than the original one. The original one was pretty big. It's quite hefty, but it was fun to make. And Joss Whedon called me Captain Etsy.
So. Oh, that's awesome. Man, you're going to be busy the months before the convention.
The thing is, too, is I'm also making a quilt for some friends of mine for their wedding.
Oh, gosh.
A Doctor Who themed quilt.
So you're not going to have a life in the next month and a half.
No, I was basically. So glad. I was actually really stoked when Ren Fair was over. Because as soon as Ren Fair was over, just to clarify, I help with a game booth at the Renaissance Pleasure Fair in Southern California every year. And I love it with every fiber in my being, and it's super fun, but it's exhausting. And this year I was glad when it was over because I can get focused. I can get working. I moved recently, so I have a nicer place now where I can really stay very organized, and all my yarn that took up like about 10 bins. I think I moved 10 bins of yarn in my move.
Wow.
And the Groot pen cozies.
Oh, right. Those are cute too.
Really like the Groot pen cozies. So Jeff, is yours. Obviously it's Star Trek is probably your number one geekdom, but if you had to pick a different one that you had to focus on, which would it be?
Oh God, that's a tough one. Wow.
Just one.
That's a tough one.
Just one. It would have to take the place of Star Trek.
So it has to take the place of Star Trek?
Yeah, let's say Star Trek didn't exist and we all were sad and lonely and depressed all the time.
Oh, good God.
Which one would you pick?
Are my choices limited or is this...
Nah, whatever.
Oh,
I have a friend who would probably say Zelda.
Zelda's good.
Like, he's obsessed with it.
Zelda's good. Well, I was obsessed with Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy for a long time. Still am.
See? And I have nothing. I have nothing that has to do with that. And so I feel like I leave out a few geekdoms here and there, and I don't, you know what I mean? That's why I'm always trying to find out, what do you want? What do you want to see? What's your geekdom? So that I can try.
Well, you know what else, too? It's only a single movie, but I have a lot of trouble finding any merchandise because it's an old film now, but the Disney film, The Black Hole from 1979, I have very few items, but what I do have are very precious.
I was thinking The Black Cauldron, but no, I'd have to look that one up. I'm so sad.
Aww.
Someone's going to take my name Mickey away from me.
It was essentially Disney's answer to Star Wars.
Oh, fine. Mm. Okay. Well, now they have the solution to Star Wars.
Now they own it. They couldn't beat it, so they bought it.
That's $4 billion between friends. I'd have to look that one up. But if there was something specific, like I said, I never would have thought to do Marvin the Martian.
Yeah.
But someone, and unfortunately, I made it. And then she's like, oh, I don't have any money. And I'm like, oh, okay. So FYI, I'll be taking deposits
on
orders from now on. But, you know, I don't mind. It's fine. I don't, this is my only, I don't have a day job or anything. I don't actually technically need one. So this is a good hobby. It keeps me busy. It keeps me, you know, idle hands, as they say. And I love doing it. You know, I miss the gifting part of it though.
Yeah.
I really do. You know, I slowed down this year's a little bit. Again, why I outsourced a little bit more, because my Christmas presents were so intense. I made mermaid tail blankets.
Oh, right. I've seen those.
Yeah. And the shark. Did you see the shark?
I don't remember if I saw the shark.
Oh, that was the most boring thing on the planet to make. So much gray.
Yeah.
So I made a shark blanket for my nephew and mermaid tails for all the girls. And those take about a month to make.
Yeah,
I believe. Do you, else.
Do you? Would you do those like special order for people? If
I would, but it would. It would cost a pretty. You know, It would cost more than what you would pay for a blanket. And that's what.
Yeah.
I feel so bad because my best friend tells me all the time, and most people tell me all the time, you undercharge, you undersell. I undersell myself.
Right. You
know, when I sell a beanie cap for $35. I'm not being paid by the hour.
Yeah.
It didn't take me 3.5 hours to make.
Yeah.
You know, it took me probably 8, if not 4. Some things take all day.
Yeah.
And I can't charge $80 for that. That's crazy.
Well.
And I'm not going to, and I'm not ever going to. But I do hope that people realize how much work goes into it.
I think they do, and I think that's why they tell you they will pay more to charge more.
No, yeah, and they, you know, and but then I get it from the other side too.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I do. You know, I had one lady during the yard sale when I was passing out the flyers, who said, "Well, I expect yard sale prices."
Oh my!
It's like, honey, I'm not selling my old knickknacks.
Yeah. Maybe she just had the wrong idea of what there might be. Because honestly, some of the stuff in the vendor's room does look like yard sale.
There's
different things. And there's some of those booths with like the toys and the ornaments and the...
They were great. All that Disney stuff, the toys, all that stuff. That was great. But all I could think is like, are you sure you're in the right place?
Yeah, it's definitely a mix. And we've talked a little bit about like what we might see. And some of the... Jeff, who was it that mentioned something about, was it Larry that said something about having more of like the phone case people?
Yeah. Oh, Larry was telling me that. Yeah.
Well, that too. And I was itching and moaning.
Yeah. And that was just
phone,
the strangest thing. It was just the strangest thing. And we're like, we don't want more of that. We want like more of Mickey stuff, more make it so. Mm-hmm.
I want more. Not the charger guys.
No, like, you know, no. Unless like it's some kind
cases,
of...
If they had, like, Star Trek theme phone cases,
exactly.
I would be very happy.
Yeah,
I have
something...
yet to find one that I can get that's a good case.
Yeah.
The good sturdy case, because I may or may not drop my phone often.
Yeah. Yep, I do. I'm in the same boat. Same
God.
Boat.
Well, rumor has it you can get a shore leave phone case now.
Oh, yes, you can.
An iPad case and a laptop case.
But is it an otter? Oh, no. But no, that would that would be a fun one, too. But if they had those available at the convention, that'd be nice. The phone charger people, however.
Yeah, no, that's different. Different altogether.
That was like, number one, hawking at its worst.
Yeah. Yeah, because they would kind of come after you. As you walked, it's like at the mall.
What do you mean you don't have this? What do you mean you don't have this? Well, your phone's going to die. Honey, I have a suite here that I will go put my phone up in if I need to. Sir. But no, I'm probably, they're probably going to stick me in some empanada tower thing.
Empanada tower,
though. Are you staying at the Rio this year?
Yeah, the Ipanema. Yay. I stay in Ipanema because overall, like, I've just had a better experience over there.
Really?
Yeah.
I like Masquerade.
Some people do. I mean, it's a little further. It's closer to the bar.
Yeah, that's why. I'm not even a drinker. But I like being able to just go straight up to my room after the end night. Yes, if I forget something in my room from the convention room, I'm turning my pedometer on. I'm walking that mile.
Yeah, you know? We've talked about that. I'm like, should I wear my Fitbit at the convention? Because I'm really curious to see how many steps you walk that whole day. Mile. But I'm like, but that would not go. That is not Starfleet regulation with any of my cosplay.
So, Heather, just for reference, I was averaging about 26 or 27,000 steps a day last year.
Oh, my gosh.
According to my watch.
Well,
and I think mine lies to me, and I do a lot more than it says, but that's just me trying to be positive.
Yeah, they're not 100% accurate. That's been proven.
Like, there's no way I only walked. Today, we walked, it said, 3 miles. I don't believe it. I think it was more than that. It felt more than that. And at Gay Pride, it said I only walked about 5 miles. I'm like, oh, no. Oh, no.
Is it in your phone or is it just
it's
like
on my phone.
Yeah. Okay. See, I think that the phones are just nowhere. They're not as accurate as like the ones that you wear, like a Fitbit or whatever.
But I don't. Yeah, exactly. But I understand what you're saying. I don't want to wear that.
Yeah. It's the one I have is a little bulky.
Can it go around your ankle? Like an ankle monitor, like you're on like house arrest.
No,
like if you drink, it'll start buzzing.
You need to go to bed now.
It is time for you to your go limit. To bed, Heather.
You will have a killer hangover tomorrow if you don't go to bed now. We should develop that to give to everybody.
And it would remind them to drink a large glass of water right
yes.
before.
Yes. Have you had your water?
Don't forget to hydrate.
Oh, goodness. Goodness.
It'll be fun this year, though. Lots more jewelry, too. I've got something you're going to want.
Ooh.
I definitely have something you're going to want. I might have to... You and the sister wives, I might have to... What? I have sister wives. I am the registered of the sister wives because I am third wife. I really want to make us cosplay for it, too. I wish I had time. To make a gold, a blue, and a red sister wife dress for our Admiral husband to pop around.
That would be funny.
I did get my red TOS dress in the mail.
Oh, nice.
Put it on. My daughter said I looked quite slim. I was like,
oh well, you've been working hard. We have our STLV bod thing going on where a bunch of us have just been working out and stuff. Right? So I see you checking into the gym. There is one.
FitFan, there's FitFan Girl, right?
There is. It's 50 by 50th. I will just add you to it because it's specifically awesome. The Star Trek people. There's only 107 members, and we just kind of post about what we're doing and try to motivate each other.
We should have more competitions.
Yeah,
challenges.
We try to do
not like competitions, but like challenges, like self challenges. Like there are 47 stairs to my front doorstep now.
Wow.
Kill me. Yeah. My grocery intake has gone way down. But you know, like we should set out challenges and stuff. I think that'd be fun. Because I think and it doesn't matter what we look like. We don't need to lose that weight. None of us. You look great the way you are. I look fine the way I am. You know what I mean? None of us need. Nobody out there, not one girl or guy, needs to change themselves or to take drastic measures to modify their body. If anything, we are the most accepting and most loving of communities.
Yes. That's why I tell people, I'm like, don't be wary about your cosplay, you know, just wear what you wear, rock it. And at the end of the day, like all that your STLV bod is just bringing your body to the Star Trek convention.
Exactly. And I think that's great, but I think motivation is good. I do like going to the gym.
Yeah.
I like held accountable.
Yeah.
I am a fan of being held accountable because I will slack off every chance I get.
Well, I added you to the 50 Yay. By 50th group, so we're good there.
Perfect. And then are you getting any photo ops? I'm getting a photo op with Whoopi Goldberg.
I don't know that I'm going to do any photo ops. I mean, if I'm there and something kind of jumps out, I might do it, but I don't know.
Well, you've probably pretty much gotten most of them, right?
Yeah. I mean, this is... This is my eighth year. So at this, I got to take a drink of water here.
See, that's why, you know, I've been going since 2004. And vending became an option because I've seen them all speak. Yeah. I love seeing it. Last year I closed down for the Spock tribute. And then for some reason forgot to bring Kleenex and just cried into my spirit the whole time. And then, you know, a few other times I kind of bailed out. But for the most part, I've seen everybody and heard it all and all that kind of stuff. And I love it. I do love it. I love to be able to participate more in the convention itself. And this year, I have an employee.
Right.
And I have a lot of Trek family saying, hey, yep, I'd love to come by and help. If you need a break, you let me know. And I appreciate that. I appreciate that very much. Hopefully, my booth will be located where we agreed to it last year, but I haven't gotten any confirmation on that yet. So fingers crossed that they remember, or at least, you know, honor the location I picked. Because I picked a place up close. I picked first row. If you turn in, you know, you come into the vendor's room and you turn right towards all the creation stuff, you know, where your head, your photo, your packages, your coin.
Right,
you know, all that kind of stuff. So it was, do you remember the lady who had all the Comic-Con bags?
Yes.
That's the spot I picked.
Oh, wow.
Because did you come to Star Trek Convention to see a bunch of Comic-Con bags that she bought for free and is now reselling? Or would you rather see awesome handmade, for the most part, jewelry and beanie caps that don't belong in Southern California at all, or Las Vegas in August, but keychains and Star Trek stuff, fun stuff.
Yeah, definitely.
Stuff you're not going to see anywhere else. The ear cuffs.
Yep.
I'm going to have a ton of those. I purchased this year Dragon ear cuffs.
Ooh, fancy.
So I'll have those as well, but the handmade ones.
Awesome.
Well, we'll be there. I love making those. They tear apart my fingers. But absolutely love making them.
That is what I think ultimately, like what we've discussed. I mean, all the work and love that you put into everything is why we wanted you here for one reason. It's just, you put so much love. Everything is handmade. Now you've got stuff that you're going to customize to people. So I hope that in the next month and a half, maybe we'll check back in with you.
Yeah, for sure.
A little bit before, because we're going to keep mentioning what you're going to do. Like, yes. After all that stuff.
Yeah,
and probably just a couple weeks before the convention, I know we're going to try to do a little wrap up type thing like everything you need to know. And so I will throw out anything new that you have, and then you can update us on the tattoo stuff and how that's going.
Yeah, for sure. And then make sure people know too, like find me on Facebook.
Yes. Your Facebook? Make it so. S-E-W.
You'll see one of our favorite captains. And, you know, I don't have an Etsy.
Right.
No, I don't. You know what I mean? No, I'm not. I'm not going to pay those fees to sell nothing.
Yeah.
I was on there for 2 or 3 years. I sold nothing.
Oh, man.
Not worth it. Facebook is fine. I like selling my stuff at conventions anyways. I don't really like selling over the internet. But what I do like is suggestions.
Yes. So
my brain is already challenging. I've already thinking about the Tricorder.
Awesome. You know?
So Tricorder, not communicator, correct?
Correct.
Yeah. Okay. It'd make a great bag.
Yes. If I
could figure out a way to crochet it into like a purse.
That'd be awesome.
You know, it's structurally trying to figure out how to make it solid-ish. You know what I mean?
No, I know what you're saying.
Soft like a crocheted bag, but sturdy like a purse and a tricorder, if you will. So, but my brain is already kind of ticking towards that. I'm staring at the one that Spock is using as my piggy bank.
Well, I won't hold you to it, but I may look forward to it someday. We will see. So make it so. and
contestants. And tell me what you want to see at the convention. If you're going to the convention, tell me what you want to see, because how else am I supposed to know?
Absolutely.
You know, if people are like, oh, we love the Wesley Crusher hats. Yes. Great. I'll make, you know, the Shut Up Wesley. I'll make a ton of them.
Yes.
You know, if you like the Spock hats, I'm just going to keep pumping those out like it's the only thing I'll make. I just, you know, I felt bad. I sold out last year, first night. No one even got to see them after that. So
this year. We will make sure to keep your post about the suggestions high in the unofficial Star Trek Las Vegas group.
Love it.
So that people will see it. And
I hope everybody can get their tickets, and I hope that there's not a problem with people being able to come in and wander.
Yep. You know? Yep. The good thing is that with it being sold out, there will be lots of people there. My biggest concern is just the space. But you have a prime spot.
I hope. Fingers crossed.
You'll be good. And then anybody, if you have trouble finding Mikki, just come find one of us and we will take you to her.
Yay. And I would love to meet everybody and see everybody.
Yay.
Anything, it's all good. We'll just have a
friend in all of us, as we like to say. Oh, all righty.
Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you so much for coming on. We love you.
Love you.
Hi there, thanks again for listening. If you're cruising the galaxy looking for even more Trek talk, why not visit our good friends Bill and Dan over at TrekGeeks.com? They've got a great podcast that covers a wide range of Star Trek topics, so you're sure to find something you'll love. And if you're in the mood for some awesome tunes, then you really need to head over to 5YearMission.net. The guys are writing a song for every episode of the original series, and each one is absolutely brilliant. So that's TrekGeeks.com and 5YearMission.net. Check them out today.